We're looking at flooding, why water gets places where we don't want it to be. And this is a good starting point for that. It locates where the water from field drainage, surface drainage, begins its journey into the larger ditches that end up in a river. What we see up to the left is a smaller ditch or a road ditch that has been, you know, used for a drainage of the field. And this culvert, or this bridge, if you want, runs through at about 30,000 gallons a minute when it's full. The rocks that are surrounding that hole are intended to stop the creation of a pond in front of that hole, which is common and normal for nature to do. That pond is the place where fish spawn to create new young. They do it here when the river is fast and flowing. They swim upstream and deposit their eggs here so that large fish can't get to them later on down the road after the water is gone. So they have a chance to grow up before they encounter that. If the water is flowing fast and high, it will get nearly to the road, and it might even go over the road. And it will certainly go out into the field beside it. And we're going to track our way back to the basic beginning of where the headwater is. We don't need to go all the way back there, but this little area here drains a few hundred acres. I'm not sure exactly how many, but let's just say 500 for the sake of it. Now we're going to go back in a bit to see that the drainage ditches are mowed, and the reason they're mowed is because agriculture wants the water to flow as fast as possible so that there is no water left in the field for any longer than it must be. The reason they don't want water in the field is because the plants will drown. It also creates terrible problems for planting and harvest and weeds and what have you. And there can be diseases and insects and all kinds of things that come up with that. So the idea is to get the water off of the field as fast as possible. That, of course, creates problems downstream. In this area here, there's a small waterway that cuts across the field that you can't see. The plants go right through the waterway, and when the water comes, the water goes through the plants and into this little ditch here. This is what connects to what you saw a little bit earlier. And it's and the headwaters are actually straight ahead of you and another mile or two down the road. So it goes down there, and then it runs in through the road ditch and runs around and comes to the field. Now the reason that this actually is the way it is because when you saw a minute ago, there was a short distance that could have been used over in the, there's a large ditch over there, but there was a farmer 100 years ago that screamed and cried and failed to recognize that we all have to do our share. And anyway, he got his way, and the end result of that is that the drainage ditch ran down this road and then off to another ditch a mile away. That was irresponsible. That should not have been done by the drainage district commissioner either. But he gave away because the man was just too belligerent. He didn't want the fight. So, and who does? But sometimes you must. Nonetheless, what we have to decide is what can we do or not do that will help the situation of flooding downstream. Every farmer will tell you that he just has to, he can't stop the flow of water or change the direction of water, but he doesn't have to be concerned at all with who has to take the water downstream. He'll say, they just have to take the water, and that's that. It's the law. That's what they'll tell you every single time, and they're very belligerent about that. They want their water gone. It costs money to have water sitting in the field, and so it's about dollars and cents And you have to change the law to make a difference in that. This now is a picture of a larger drainage ditch. This is a mile down the road from where we were at the beginning. And this is a second bridge a mile down the road, and it has a pond. It's been here for 30, 40 years, and the pond does have minnows and things in it. Lots of things do drink here. We have wildlife is still around. There isn't but very little bit. All the habitat is gone, and for a wide variety of reasons, it just doesn't. It goes, the drainage goes another quarter mile down the road to this ditch. This is a larger ditch, as you can see, and it connects eventually to the river. First we have to go, this shows you a little drainage ditch. We're using the roads here to connect to that drainage ditch too. What we have to understand is this is straight and narrow, and the purpose of that is to make the water flow faster. Agriculture digs out the ditches and tries to slope the sides so that it doesn't wash away, and the end result is they want a straight and fast B so that the water will run out and leave very little sediment behind. The faster it goes, the less sediment it leaves. So it's rather important. If you look in the bottom of that water, you can see minnows in there. You know, there is life in these waters, a little bit, which means that the poison that's used in agriculture hasn't killed at all, but nonetheless, it's not so good. So this is the other side of that bridge, and it just shows you that this is straight and narrow is what agriculture wants, and the purpose of that is to get rid of the water fast. That, of course, sends water downstream in a large hurry, and it also adds in, there's tiling in these fields, and the tiling used to be only what was needed. Today, however, the new theory created by the university is that it should be massive tiling, a tile every 50 feet or so, I think it is, throughout the entire field for the length of the field, and that all dumps into the ditch. And when it dumps into the ditch, of course, there's a lot more water flowing than there used to be when there was minimal amounts of tile, and a more appropriate method of going on. When water doesn't sit in the field long enough, it doesn't sink down into the ground fast enough or during time, and it doesn't end up in the aquifer beneath us. So it does matter how much tiling you have, and it does matter how much water goes down, and it does matter how much water you take out of an aquifer. The aquifer fill rate is 1 inch for every 50 inches of rainfall, according to the Water Geologic Service of the United States, or of the state of Illinois. They say every 50 inches of rain around here produces 1 inch of water in the aquifer beneath our feet. So it is important what we do in more ways than one. Nonetheless, what we have to do is keep a walking along this path to see what we can do about the water that ends up in that ends up putting debris in lakes and causing flooding in towns and so on. The problem is we don't have the resources to rebuild every little flooding area in a town. And we are so many more people than we used to be. They built next to the water, closed up the sides of the ditch, and tried to keep more water in a smaller place all the time. That does not work. You know, the water builds up higher, the water goes faster, and it floods the people downstream. And every town does it too. They all try to keep the water from spreading out. And they, you know, towns have lots of pavement and concrete and gutters and things, and they try to get rid of their water as fast as possible too. And so it ends up in the rivers, and the rivers rise, and the water goes faster, and more damage is done every mile downstream you go. Because you have to actually put in retention ponds along these waterways, along these ditches, so that water that's going to be too much for downstream can stop and wait in a spot that's, just off to the side of the ditch here, and able to be released later on when the flood has abated. A retention pond is very important to flood control, and you have to have one every little bit, or otherwise you don't have a place for massive rainfall. Even so, in a case like this ditch here, you can widen the ditch a little bit and create a lot more room for water. Now, you just pushed that a mile. Well, here we go with another ditch a little bit. It's a tributary further upstream again, and it's here just to take you a look for what's down the river. You see all the how it's closed up and how the water weaves back and forth a little bit, and it doesn't look very deep. Well, that's sediment in the bottom of the ditch. And it grows grass, and that plugs up the water that fills the ditch. And when the ditch fills and the water overflows and gets into the field, and there's no place for the water to go in the ditch, so agriculture has a drainage commissioning system, and those drainage commissioners come out and they dig out these ditches and put it on the sides of the ditch and make the ditch higher so that it holds more water. So you have to have, they need to get rid of the water out of the field so that their plants don't die and you can eat. But they have their intent is to take as much of the water as fast as it can go and get rid of it to you, whoever is downstream. Just like every city, they want the water gone too, and just as fast as they can go. But that is not good for the environment or the animals or any other thing. You cannot just flood downstream because you want to not spend any money. They have to accept your debt when that happens. So everybody has a legal responsibility to do what they can for the drainage themselves. Now, this is an area that is set aside. The farmer is paid to keep a berm here for wildlife, although it's not supposed to be mowed until a certain date, and I'm not sure exactly what date would that be. But this you can't really see it, but there's about a 3-foot rise from the field to the ditch bank, and that's from all the sediment that has been taken out over the years. Well, this is we're at the just short of the river, actually. And what makes a river is how big a fish it can support, basically. And so there are large fish in here. If you look, not a lot of them, but there are some. If you look one way, that is headed to a suburban area. There are houses down past that another little ways. And it's a rough area that floods a lot, so farmers don't really want it for cultivating crops. If we look the other way, it has no trees because farmers do not want trees. Trees are an impediment to water flow. They cause the ditch to close up. They catch debris, and when debris is caught, it stops the water flow a little bit. And so drainage commissioners dig out all the trees. City people want trees. So wherever you have city people, you have some trees along the ditch bank. Wherever you have just farmers in control, you have no trees along the ditch bank. And if you have them, they will be cut out so that they don't get washed out and then fall into the ditch, and then the ditch is plugged, and then the fields are flooded. and it has to be all cleaned and somebody is losing money. Well, this is a retention pond. It's actually a little Homer Lake Park that was plugged up in 72 or somewhere in there. And it shows you one of the problems with the retention pond. Do you see the algae on the water? Any amount of still water will grow algae and become stagnant and it will stink. So you need moving water to keep the algae down. This is a small drainage district, actually. This controls, again, a few hundred acres, not a lot. And it has a value. You know, this is now a park. They've allowed trees to grow up. You know, it's not the best park in the world, but it has value. And so, you know, retention ponds can be good for people. Agriculture doesn't like them because agriculture wants every square inch of ground that it can get. Not my dirt, but it's going to be somebody's dirt. Unfortunately, there's only so much dirt. And we have crops to grow. And if we don't grow the crops, we don't eat. It is a very important cycle. And if we continue looking, here's the other side of that retention pond or a little park. It's coming over the dam, which means it's been raining recently. And the water ends up here and it starts flowing. And what you saw is algae down at the other end will soon disappear as that algae is actually washed over the edge and distributed throughout. So this is a nice little area. And it shows you that the dam is about, 15 feet tall, or I think the bottom of this little lake is 25 feet. Over on the other end where the algae is, it was like 2 feet. This is the spillway, and there's a guy fishing down there. But he won't catch much. I asked him. So that's because it's overfished, you know. Here it is again. This shows you the size of the little river that feeds that little lake. This is combined. This is basically the size of the drainage flow. This is where water is allowed to do what it wants to do. And it snakes around, curve after curve after curve, and impedes the flow of water because that's what water does. You know, the trees grow up and that stops the water, and then the water goes around the tree and it cuts out the ditch somewhere else, and it creates a whole little living landscape and tries to create a marshland in some places where it just sits there. And that's because water, by nature's definition, should not go fast so that life has a chance to work with it. Anyway, farmers don't like that. That's because it costs them money. And city people don't like that either. This is the actual river where the water out of those ditches ends. It's after 12, 15 miles of flow. And it combines with, you know, some other areas. And I'm not sure how many thousand acres it's actual drainage of. Quite a few. When the water is running fast, this whole area is covered with water. You can't see very well in here, but there are trees rooted out, and there are trees that cut along the bank and dirt washed out as the river and continues to grow. It cuts the dirt so that it actually makes room for itself, and it's still cuts around the corners and what have you. This is through the park, so the drainage district is not allowed to come in here and straighten it out, because that's what they do if they could. They want it straight and fast and as fast as possible. And again, city people don't want their water to stay either. This is a city retention pond. Specifically made as a retention pond. They dug it out something like 40 feet deep, and they made it big enough to hold 40 million gallons or so. while this has, you know, nice little facets to it, it's meant to be flooded. And it has been flooded right up to the top of the concrete before. This is what you see in the bubbles is an aeration pump to keep the algae down. And that's necessary or it will stink. That over there is a waterfall, a little man-made waterfall. And there's another little man-made waterfall over there to keep the algae at bay. And if you, this connects to a little, to a ditch underneath the, abridgment there, that concrete. And anyway, it goes into the University of Illinois property in Champaign, Urbana, and the university covered up that ditch entirely, or almost entirely. So the water backs up, and the city had to do something. What you see now is the Memorial Stadium. I know it isn't a very good picture, but it's a football stadium. And that little silver building in the that keeps a weaving across the part here is an emperor's box. The emperor's box cost $120-some million a few years ago, and they use it six times a year for a half an hour, for an afternoon. It's football. And it's nothing more and nothing less, although they put a couple of classrooms in it to justify it. When we see the assembly hall here, The U of I spent $154 million, well, the state of Illinois spent $154 million to upgrade that. Didn't change a thing outside except put a coating on the roof. Don't know what they did on the inside. $154 million worth. $120 million for an emperor's box on the football stadium. If we look over to the other side, that little building in the back there is I think it was a $20 million little area for the football players to play in out of the rain, or so they wouldn't get a little cold. It's a secondary little box so they can hide behind the walls. And of course in the $1 million payoffs for the football coaches, and over in the distance there, that's a $80 million tennis building, and that's over there, there's a $15 million baseball arena or some such thing as that, you know. That's where our money for any actual, real, necessary improvements for the rest of us goes. It goes to the U of I in the state of Illinois, anyway. And they spend it on their toys. Nothing more than that. They spend it on their toys, trinkets, and trophies. As we look to, this is a field of soybeans around here. What we grow out here is soybeans and corn. Almost exclusively. Soybeans and corn produce sugars, oils, and livestock feed mostly. And what we have to understand about any and all of this is that our options are no longer as simple as they used to be. In the next 10 years, worldwide population will grow another 1 billion people. That's not a guess, that's a reality. We will add another 1 billion people more than there are today within 10 years. Doesn't matter what liars are trying to change the reports to say, that's the facts. So, every human being believes they're going to live 100 years. And every single day of that 100 years, they need food, they need water, they need resources, they need space. You know, every single year of your life you have needs, and we need to eat other life to survive. These plants are other life. You know, meat is other life, fish is other life. If we don't have other life, if we don't sustain the habitat for other life, if we don't care about other life, we don't eat ourselves. Those are the facts. So, you can start at least trying to realize that the reality of our lives has changed because we are so many people and we must make different decisions. And that includes the people who are being flooded out because we have not the resources to rebuild all that stuff. You think you're just going to take all your stuff and insurance is going to buy you a new house and buy you new stuff, and it does. But it does, because in America, we are providing the report, so I'm going to guess it's at $158 trillion of debt right now, and they're claiming $212 trillion by now in assets. Last time I looked, it was $153 trillion a year or two ago, and it was $202 trillion in assets. $202 trillion divided by 8 billion people, which is about what we are, is $25,000 or $28,000 per human face on the planet. Think about that. We're not playing, we're playing a game. There's no reality associated with it, other than the fact, if we don't change ourselves and protect our environment and protect the habitat for other creatures that we need, and you don't know how many you need them all to create a chain of life. We don't stop doing that or start doing what we need to do. There is no future. There is no future. You've assassinated the children. And as we go on, we get to the reality of more university tragedies. And the one that stands out most is the fact that they're trying to ignite sunfire here on Earth. The sun is over 10 million degrees, or 10 million degrees. It has, according to the scientists, 1 million-mile-long flames, more or less. And they say the sun is made entirely of hydrogen gas, the lightest known atomic element, yet they call the sun the densest object in our solar system. That doesn't add up. The least dense element cannot be the most dense object. Hydrogen cannot be made more dense unless it is extremely cold. That is not the sun. They say the sun at its core is hottest at its core, which would mean every single bit of fuel the sunfire needs is engulfed at once. We know the sun has burned thousands, if not millions, of years. If every bit of fuel is on fire at the same time, that does not add up. They say the fire on the sun comes from fusion, two hydrogen atoms forced to combine into one helium atom. Lawrence Livermore Laboratories in San Francisco has already proven this is false. More clearly, however, if two hydrogen atoms makes a helium atom for every few BTUs of heat the sun generates, then where is the helium? Helium does not burn. Doesn't add up. They say solar gravity, which holds our solar system together, is caused by the density of materials. Hydrogen, they say, at the core of the sun. That's what they say the sun is made of. Yet the sun is surrounded by 10 million degree flames, which are guessed to be a million miles or more long. Fire pushes out. Fire is not a material mass producing gravity. It's a law of thermodynamics. It doesn't add up. They don't even have a theory for what gravity is, other than bigger mass means more gravity. If the sun is all fire, as they say, it cannot be that mass. They say igniting a star, same fire as is on the sun, is perfectly safe here because there is not enough gravity to sustain the fire, or it's too much heat, it will just leave our atmosphere and disappear into space. However, because of the heat the sun produces and its longevity, that is an atomic fire, which means the fuel source is atoms, which means everything on our Earth is fuel. Wrong is a planet on fire. And there are no 10 million degree fire extinguishers, which means there are no second chances. There are several extreme experiments around this world trying to ignite an atomic fire. Same fire as is on the sun, here on this Earth. A fire that burns our skin from 91 million miles away in summer. At Lawrence Livermore, the National Ignition Facility, they built a sphere chamber with 192 powerful lasers, all directed at the center spot. They claim pressures approaching 0.5 trillion PSI at a heat generated on that center spot of 180 million degrees Fahrenheit. And there are even more extreme experiments coming. They will ignite an atomic fire here on Earth if not stopped. Every life, every future life on this planet will be decided when that ignition occurs, because if an atomic fire does not put itself out, just like the sun, our entire planet will burn. No second chances. If atoms on fire refuse to extinguish it themselves, then we all die. What is not made of atoms here? Are we not all fuel? Stand up and say no, because we cannot be wrong without our entire planet dying. So you cannot do this anymore. The courts, however, say the university cannot be questioned. The media says the university cannot be wrong. The leaders say we believe in the university. And they leave no other options than to try to enlighten you. The universities get power, the right to control, pride, to demand we are the winners here, purpose, we are important, money, we can get anything we want and more. So even when they prove themselves wrong, as they did with fusion, they still won't stop, because if their experiments end, they lose their job and all that goes with it. It's that simple and plain.